What do you think of when you think of Malibu, California? Do you think of the beautiful sunsets, the exquisite beaches, maybe the beautiful celebrity mansions? That's what draws a lot of people to Malibu. Sadly, not everyone comes home. My name is Patrick, and today I will tell you the story of Mitra Slavon Richardson.
I think the only way I will come and get her tonight is if you guys are going to release her tonight. If she's going to be held in custody for some type of arraignment tomorrow, then I will wait until tomorrow. She definitely has no place, you know, I mean, she's not from that area, and I would hate to wake up to a morning report, girl lost somewhere with her head chopped off.
So. My priest Richardson name was Spears or Lohan. They would never let her walk out by her by herself. They would have escorted her home.
Around all you seekers of the night, welcome to Patrick's Dark Corner.
The story of Mitra Richardson would have surely been front page news if it happened today during the Black Lives Matter movement. Still though, I think it's important Mitra's story be shared. She has never gotten justice and her family has never gotten answers. Mitra was born in 1985 to her father Michael and her mother Latisse. The two eventually separated, and Latisse remarried a man named Larry Sutton. Latisse taught Mitra that she could be anything she wanted to be, but she expected Mitra to give 100% in everything that she did. Mitra seemed to take this advice to heart. Her grades were perfect. She danced and did cheerleading and beauty pageants.
What one technological advancement do you wish had never been invented?
Cell phones. Although when you're stranded, they help contact your family and the need of a spare tire or just in any need of emergency, but they also cause a lot of accidents and they cause a lot of friendships from forming because as soon as people get out of class, the first thing they want to do is talk on their cell phones. So I just wish that cell phones would be limited to just emergencies only.
Mitra was definitely a girly girl. Her family would often go out on hikes, but Mitra preferred to stay at home and read a book. She thought bugs were disgusting and hated the dirt. Mitra grew up in West Covina in California. Her parents fled East Los Angeles during the Rodney King riots to start a better life for Mitra in West Covina. When it was time for college, Mitra attended Cal State Fullerton. Mitra was the first in her family to attend college, so everyone was proud of her. It was in college that Mitra came out to her family as a lesbian. The family is said to have been totally accepting. While in college, Mitra lived with her great-grandmother Mildred. Mildred lived closer to the college, so it made more sense for Mitra to live with her rather than commute all the way from Covina. Plus, Mitra could keep Mildred company and help her with stuff, so it seemed like a win-win for everyone. Mildred had actually kind of raised Mitra since her parents were still in high school when Mitra was born, so this was kind of a full circle moment. Anyway, Mitra thrived academically. In 2008, she graduated Cal State with honors and received her degree in psychology. After college, Mitra had big dreams she wanted to pursue in master's and eventually a doctorate degree, and she wanted to open a clinic for the LGBT community. In the meantime, Mitra continued living with Mildred and got a couple of jobs. One was at this shipping company in Santa Fe Springs. Her second job was as a dance at a gay and lesbian club called Debra's in Long Beach. Mitra's father was concerned for her safety with this job, but she assured him she was just a go-go dancer, not a stripper. Still, he worried.
Mitra was also pursuing modeling, and she would meet up with photographers in sketchy areas. She attended a party at the Playboy Mansion as a guest model. Mitra became infatuated with this girl named Vanessa, who worked at the shipping company with her. Vanessa was already with someone and didn't share the same feelings. Mitra started withdrawing from friends and stopped replying to texts. She posted bizarre ramblings on Facebook and MySpace at all hours of the night. She was also sending texts to family and friends that made no sense. Things changed forever though on September 16th, 2009. That day, Mitra showed up at her job at the shipping yard in a good mood, but on her lunch break, she left and never returned. Mitra stopped by her aunt's house and scattered her business cards all over the lawn. She attached notes to the aunt's car that said, "I Uncle Johnny Jimmy," and "Black woman scorned." that night, Matris was supposed to have dinner with her great-grandma, Mildred, like she did every Wednesday night. When Matris got home, she told Mildred that she wanted to go by the ocean and follow the lights, or something along those lines. She asked Mildred if they could have dinner a different night. Then Matris drove 2 hours all the way to Malibu and ended up at this restaurant named
Joffrey's Malibu, an oceanside dining experience. At Joffrey's Malibu, many ingredients combine to create a classic restaurant, from a rich history to one of the most unforgettable oceanside settings in the world, and a unique menu of California cuisine. Joffrey's is a popular dining spot for celebrities, politicians, and ambassadors.
When Matris arrived to the restaurant, the valet asked Matris to wait while he parked another customer's car, then he would come back and park hers. When the valet came back, he found Matris in his car rummaging through CDs. The valet asked Matris what she was doing, and she replied, "It's subliminal." She also said she was there to avenge the death of Michael Jackson and asked if Vanessa was there. Before entering the restaurant, Matris told the valet to beware of a woman with tattooed arms. She got herself one drink, and then she kind of just invited herself to join this large group of about 10 people who were sitting down eating. She ordered herself a steak, and she started talking to these people about astrology messages she was getting from God. She said she was from Mars and that her mother was Mother Earth. All kinds of just insane, off-the-wall stuff. Eventually, the group left, and Matris was asked how she was going to pay for her $89 tab.
That was when Matris said she was busted, she had no money. That actually was not true. She actually had a debit card with like $2,000 on it in her car, so she could have easily paid for the meal. But obviously, with her mental state being what it was at the time, she wasn't thinking clearly. So what happened was, she got the restaurant to call her great-grandmother Mildred. Mildred tried to give the restaurant her credit card number over the phone. They said, "No, you need to come here to sign it or fax us a signature." And this is an elderly woman, so of course she couldn't do any of that. Eventually, the employees at the restaurant started to scrap in together some money just to pay for my mistress's bill. They just wanted to get this weird girl out of here. But the manager insisted that his staff call the police. Not so much because he cared about the unpaid bill, apparently. He didn't feel that she was in a state to drive.
Lawsville Sheriff Station, Deputy Shalef, how can I help you?
Hi, I'm calling from Joffrey's Restaurant in Malibu.
Yeah.
We have a guest here who is refusing to pay her bill, and we think she may, she sounds really crazy, she may be on drugs or something. We are wondering if someone can come by and pick her up.
Okay, well, what's the address there?
It's 27400 Pacific Coast Highway.
And is she a white, black, Asian, Hispanic?
She's a young black girl. She's probably in her 20s.
Okay, what's she wearing?
She's wearing a black T-shirt and I think blue jeans.
Is she with anybody else?
No, it's just her.
So then the police showed up and they gave Matris a field sobriety test to see if she was sober, and she passed that test. The cops do, however, find a small amount of Mary Jane in her car. They then cuffed her and drove her 2 miles to the Lost Hills Sheriff's Station. Apparently, Latisse got word of what was going on, and she called the jail.
I'm calling. I'm a little frazzled right now. I understand my daughter is being brought into the station. My Therese Richardson, have they made it to the station yet, and she's been booked.
Okay, do you know where she's coming from?
Some restaurant out in Malibu, and I didn't even think to get the name. The manager's
name
is...
The only place we have somebody that's in custody that they just announced on the radio that they're coming up is from Joffrey's in Pacific Coast Highway.
It's the
only female that's being brought up to the station as we speak. They actually just put it on the radio right before you called.
Okay. I'm her mother.
Oh, okay.
And are you guys want to book her and then release her on her own recognizance tonight, because it's dark, she doesn't have a car, and I don't want her wandering out. I'm totally just taken aback because this is so out of character for her.
Yeah.
And you'll see when she comes in, she's well-spoken. I think the only way I will come and get her tonight is if you guys are going to release her tonight.
Yeah.
If she's going to be held in custody for some type of arraignment tomorrow, then I will wait until tomorrow. She definitely has no place, you know, I mean, she's not from that area, and I would hate to wake up to a morning report, lost somewhere with her head chopped off. Uh-oh. So I guess I would have to come and get her. Oh, my God.
Yeah, we're in Agoura Hills. The only thing is, at least in the station here, she will be separated, so nobody's going to be with her. So at least that's, you know, the plus thing, so you don't have to worry about her safety.
No, I feel safe with her being in custody. It's being released that I'm worried about. It's crazy out here. All right, well, then I will more than likely call and touch bases with you guys a little bit later.
Okay. Yeah, she'll call you as soon as she comes in, too.
Maitrice was booked and put in a jail cell. Strangely, the police report makes no mention of Maitrice's strange behavior. If concerns about her mental health were listed, she could have been held for closer observation or even hospitalized on a 72-hour hold. The payphones were supposedly down in the jail that night, so they let Maitrice use the phone at the front desk. She made 4 different phone calls, and cops claim they saw Maitrice talking on the phone. However, her family said she didn't have any phone numbers memorized, aside from her great-grandma Mildred, who wasn't called. At 12:45 a.m., Maitrice was released, basically into the canyons. She had no car, no phone, no credit cards, no money, nothing.
Maitrice's mom, Latisse, wakes up early in the morning and finds out that Maitrice had been released. Cops said they offered Maitrice to stay in a cell or lobby till the morning, but she refused. They said she was an adult and her charges were not serious enough to hold her. They claimed Maitrice showed no signs of a mental illness. No one offered her a ride, so Latisse starts calling everyone asking if they've heard from Maitrice, but they hadn't. So Latisse calls the sheriff department.
Sheriff Station, Hannah, can I help you?
Yes, good morning. My name is Latisse Sutton. I'm calling to follow up on my daughter who was brought in last night around 10:30, 11 o'clock.
Okay, let me chat through the jailer. Hold on, please.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Lock Hill Station, Baumgartner.
Yes, hi. My name is Latisse Sutton. I called not too long ago regarding my daughter, Maitrice Richardson. How long before a missing persons report can be filed? Is it 24 or 48 hours?
That's long. Well, it depends on the circumstances, but I didn't take your call, so I'm not familiar with it. Did she just not return home after going out?
She was arrested last night. This is the first time she's been arrested. She's in an unknown area.
Mm-hmm.
That she's never been in. She's without a vehicle. Nobody can find her.
And where was this at? Where was she arrested at?
Your facility. Her name is Maitrice Richardson.
Okay. Do you know if she's here now or was she released?
They said she was released.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what time was she released?
At just shortly after 12 a.m.
Yeah, normally I wouldn't recommend doing one that soon.
Right. What is the time frame?
You know, I guess probably 24 hours would be reasonable. I mean, if there would be some mitigating factors, you know, where you know you would suspect maybe something, you know,
right. She doesn't know the area. She's never been in your area before.
Where does she live?
She is unfamiliar with that area.
Do you think she possibly could have gotten a bus home?
No. Listen, my child has never ridden a bus.
Okay.
No.
Right.
She would not know how to ride a bus.
I would probably wait till, you know, early this morning. And if she doesn't turn up, you can certainly call. I don't suspect anything bad happened.
I'm concerned because, first of all, I thought they were going to keep her overnight because she was highly intoxicated.
Mm-hmm.
Something is obviously going on with her.
Have you talked to the jailer? And
Yes, I have. He said he tried to get her to stay, but because she was an adult, they had to let her go. I believe that she is highly depressed, and she's in a depressive state.
You know, it could be possible that maybe she, I mean, there's a lot of options and a lot of possibilities, and I don't think all of them would be, you know, something dire, but I can certainly understand your fears, you know, being your daughter and all that.
Well, I think she's depressed. That's what has me
worried. That's worried you more than just her. Okay.
That and the fact that she's in an area where she doesn't know where she's at.
Yeah. Does she take medication at all?
No, she. I believe it's a state that she's in right now because of just the weird activity that's been going on.
What's your name? What's your name?
Her name is Maitreese Richardson.
Okay. And your name, ma'am?
Latisse.
Okay, Latisse. Here's what I want you to do. Why don't you wait a couple hours and give us some time to kind of, I'll go back and talk to the jailer and try and get a timeline of when she was released and, you know, make sure she's not asleep in our lobby or anything like that. And then once you give us a call back in a couple hours, if she hasn't shown up or made contact with you, then maybe we can do something for you, okay?
Then, at about 6:30 a.m., Metris is spotted. Retired news anchor Bill Smith, who lives about 6 miles from the police station, calls 911.
Sheriff Station Office, can I help you?
Yeah, hi. Hey, this is Smith at Cold Canyon. We had a prowler walking around through the backyard here, but we don't know what the situation was. I don't know if you had a unit in the area. It might do a little drive-by or something.
Okay, where's this at?
This is Cold Canyon, like Hot and Cold in Malinito. And it's in the back of the house, which is right where Wood Bluff hits Cold Canyon. And we just heard a strange woman walking through the backyard here. It's a fairly large property, and she was sitting on the steps right in the back of the house here. This is kind of a circular driveway, and the gates were closed, so we don't know where this woman came from.
This is across was Wood Bluff?
Yeah, that's right. There's a horse trail, hiking trail access through here, but we've never had this kind of thing happen before.
What's she look like? White, black, Hispanic?
A tall, slim black woman with afro hair.
How tall?
She was sitting down, stretched out on the wooden steps in the back of the house. Hard to tell, but she looked like she might have been medium to slightly tall, with a big afro hair, very skinny. And I think she was wearing maybe jeans or tight pants with a T-shirt.
You've never seen her there before?
No, never. Nobody ever does that. I mean, the people hike on the trail all the time. We, you know, the trail goes through our property, but we leave it open on purpose because it's kind of a nice thing for horses and people.
And you said she's laying across the... She was laying across the steps, or...?
She was sitting kind of sprawled out on these wooden steps in the back of the house, right against the back of the house.
Since got up and left?
She's since gone, yeah. She's been gone about 5 minutes now, but as we followed over, we thought maybe a little drive-by wouldn't be a bad idea.
And what direction was she last seen headed?
Never saw her. Once she left, she just disappeared. I moved from one window to another. I said to her, I hollered down, "Are you all right?" And she said, "I'm just resting," or something like that. But she's certainly gone out of her way to get to that close to the house, because the hiking trail's not that close. It's on the ridge.
All right, well, since we go ahead and check the area for her.
Appreciate that very much.
Not a problem, sir.
Thank you. Bye.
By the time police get there, Mitris is gone. A search dog is brought in and picks up Mitris's scent and tracks it to a neighbor's house, but then loses the scent. I should note that this area is difficult for someone to walk to, very rugged and remote with steep canyons and no streetlights. Once the media gets hold of Mitris's story, it becomes a story on cable news. In January, about 4 months after Mitris disappeared, a massive search was launched.
Effort for Maitreese Richardson continued over the weekend on the ground and in the air. Search teams with rescue dogs and on horseback combed the rugged terrain near Malibu.
We are searching about a 60 to 80 square mile area, and we're searching basically from the Malibu Lost Hills Sheriff Station onward to Malibu itself.
That Malibu Sheriff Station is the last place Richardson was seen and where her parents are laying the blame for her disappearance.
There was nothing protecting her when they allowed her to walk out that door based on policy and procedure.
Richardson was arrested after she reportedly refused to pay an $89 bill at this exclusive Malibu restaurant. Management says that she looked sober, but also described her behavior as unusual. Police found a small amount of marijuana in her car and took her into custody. She was booked, then released at about 1:30 a.m. After making a few phone calls, the 24-year-old, who her mother says was afraid of the dark and lacked street savvy, left the station with no car, no purse, or even a cell phone. The sheriff's department says it couldn't force her to stay. Meanwhile, Maitreese Richardson's parents continue to hold out hope through their frustration.
It is hard to put into words what I feel as a mother. I can tell you with absolute certainty, it feels like I have stepped into a nightmare.
So Matrice's story sparked outrage. Latisse hired a civil rights attorney who brought up that Mel Gibson was arrested for a DUI at the same sheriff's station about a year ago, and cops escorted him to his car after he was booked. So why wasn't the same thing done for this young black girl?
He didn't say it was medicinal pot and they were just looking for some excuse. It's almost like harassment to me, because I'm sitting here thinking, for whatever they did, look at the tremendous amount of expense that California is now going to incur because of all the searching for the woman, and it would have all been avoided by a simple cab fare or a ride home. This just doesn't make any sense, and it's really a tragedy.
Are way too hard on the cops. There's no evidence that they were trying to harass her. It is a crime to have pot in California if you don't have a medicinal prescription.
And you work for the cops.
Unless they
had no justification
for this.
Okay.
Look, unless they had a reason to believe that she was a danger to herself or others, they had absolutely no duty to get her home.
All right, you had your piece. Now let Leo Terrell speak.
Jane, this is the classic example of a person who's not a lawyer, who's not a law enforcement, who knows nothing about 5150. He is nothing more than a
lawyer. I am a lawyer, and I'm a
shrink. You don't know what you're talking about. You don't.
Jane, Russell, you are an attorney and a forensic psychologist. Make your point in 15 seconds so that Leo can respond and the father of the missing girl can respond.
If the cops had a reason to believe that she was a danger to herself or to others, they should not have released her. But we don't have enough evidence to hang that on the cops.
Okay, hold on.
I think you do.
You've made a point. Here's the point. She, according to a valet and other people, said she was from Mars and said she had come there to avenge Michael Jackson's death. If that's not cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, I don't know what is.
On August of 2010, 10 months after she disappeared, the skeletal, partly mummified remains of Mitris Richardson were found by park rangers in a remote area known as Dark Canyon, about 6.5 miles from the patrol station.
You're nodding your head and tell me what's going on with you right now.
I'm so sorry. I'm looking at the life of my baby flash before my eyes. My future is gone. That's, oh my God. Oh my gosh.
Matisse Fassbender should not be on national TV grieving for her daughter because the LA County Sheriff Department would not let anyone leave at 12:30 at night.
So the area where Mitris's remains were found is in a really steep canyon that is hard to walk on, and it's recommended that people don't even go there. The two park rangers found a skull with black hair attached to it. Nearby was women's clothing. Her right leg was located 6 feet up the canyon. Her left arm was flexed tightly. Shockingly, Matrice's remains seemed untouched by animals. This area is full of coyotes and vultures, yet most of her clothes were missing. The coroner ordered the police not to move the remains. Of course, the police didn't listen. They just scooped up her remains in a bag and flew away with them in a helicopter. 2 weeks later, Latisse held a vigil at the place where Mitris was found, and she came across the fingers of her own daughter. The coroner ruled Mitris's death as undetermined. There were no bullets in her skull, but because of the state of the remains, it was impossible to tell what happened. Theories of what happened to Mitris include that she wandered off and eventually died of dehydration, was bitten by a snake, or fell. Another theory is that the police killed Mitris. It's also possible that Mitris was killed by a stranger after leaving the police station. The bottom line, though, is that if Mitrice was just held at the station overnight, she would still be alive today. Both of Mitrice's parents sued the police for wrongful death and received about $450,000 each. Now, let's bring this case to present day. In 2017, the sheriff who oversaw this whole investigation, his name is Lee Baca, he was sentenced to 3 years on federal corruption charges, totally unrelated to this case. Another key figure in this case was the Attorney General of California at that time, Lee Baca's good friend, Kamala Harris.
But I also knew the profound impact law enforcement has on people's lives and its responsibility to give them safety and dignity. I knew I wanted to protect people. And I knew that the people in our society who are most often targeted by predators are also most often the voiceless and vulnerable.
Here's Maitreza's father, Michael, talking about Kamala Harris's involvement in Maitreza's case on the Yvette Carnell show.
I write this letter to Kamala Harris and I tell her, hey, you know what? When I look at you, I think of my daughter. My daughter looks like you, kind of resembles you. Very well educated, very well read, and she was very ambitious like you. And I just cannot see how you guys cannot investigate this matter. I don't see in none of the paperwork. I don't see in anything that Dr. Rhonda printed out. And I have a copy of all of this. I have everything. Mind you, they write me back and say, I'm going to investigate this matter. I go back, the news media hears about it, I have to go back and start doing these interviews again, and her numbers are starting to improve. People starting to say, hey, you know, it took her a minute, but hey, she's doing her thing now. This is all we wanted. And so I got introduced to her California Attorney General out here last winter, who ironically has the same name as the coroner that investigated Maitreza's case at the coroner's office out here. He says, so we make our introductories and everything like that. And I said, well, you know what? I'm going to give you some room. I'm not pushy. I just hope you come up with the same thing that we come up with. 4 months go by. I don't hear from him. I call him. He calls me back. And he says, well, you know, we're actively on it. But I can't disclose anything at this time because we don't want to jeopardize the investigation. I said, okay, no problem. Anything you guys need, my family is here to answer anything. Never got another call. December came. We found out Kamala Harris is now going to be our senator. The following, almost the next day, the letter is dated that after she's won and she's declared the winner, I get the letter saying there was nothing conclusive in their investigation and they drop it.
Wow, I will link to that full interview in the description box below. But yeah, that is the case of Maitreza Richardson. I'm really curious what you all think happened to Maitreza. So let me know what you think in the comments. Thanks so much for watching. And as always, I will see you very soon. Bye.
In the darkness, where secrets hide, there's a corner where the truth resides. Gather round, all your secrets of the night. Welcome to Patrick's Dark Corner, where things come to light. Patrick's Dark Corner.